It's been a really long day. Yesterday was Purim, and it was amazing. But today, Shush and Purim here in America, and real Purim going on in Israel. The World City celebrates Purim a day later, so that's Erev Shabbos for them. But it was an amazing Purim, and we are excited to be here once again in the hot seat, as I call it, for our Purim, our Pesach slew of shows that we've got coming up between now and candle lighting. The big countdown is on till Pesach. I'm very excited to have another great lineup of guests. But let's start off with our intro. Hi, everyone. I'm Naomi Nachman. I'm about all the food, all the time. I love food. I love to shop for it, cook it, eat at restaurants, anything food related. I'm a cookbook author, a personal chef. My business is called The Aussie Gourmet. I give cooking classes, I run chop competitions, and I wrote two cookbooks. One is all about Pesach, and it's Pesach season, so now I can shamelessly plug my book. I hope you'll tune in every week and hear about my cooking adventures, kosher food traveling, and sharing of great food ideas and recipes. I'd like to hear about your experiences too, so email me, naomi@nachamsiegel.com, or reach out to me on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and TikTok. Okay. As I always say, if you eat it, share it, because I like to hear what all your foodie adventures are about too. We have a great lineup of guests today. Quick review. We're going to have Shani Seidman. Remember a couple of weeks ago she was on the show, and I told you she had a great story about Pesach and matzah. So she's going to join me in a minute from Manischewitz. Then we're going to have Rebecca Saltzman from Israel, just doing a quick talk about getting organized for Pesach, which I think is so important. She's a personal organizer at home of Israel, everyone's home, the Jewish people's home, but at home in Israel. So we'll be talking to her. And then in the house, we have an incredible lineup. In the studio, we have Lauren Jamal. Am I saying it right?
Yes.
My Aussie accent, I'm never sure.
Okay.
A woman entrepreneur who made her own knife. We'll talk about that in a couple minutes. And those who are watching will see a huge lineup. Let's pan the vegetables on the show. And two of my closest friends in the foodie business, we have Susie Gornish, partner in crime. And then we have Moshe Hirsch, also partner in crime, from Central Perk. And we are really excited to talk to both of them about all their incredible food that they are doing together. All right, on the line, let's hear it for Shani Seidman. Hi, Shani. Welcome back.
Hi, Naomi. Good to be back. I haven't gotten my microphone yet.
I know, right? It's in the mail with the check.
Okay, great. I'm looking forward to
just
it.
Just checking about the check and the microphone. Actually, I think I have one from kosher.com. I'll send it to you. Next time we meet, I'll bring it to you.
Awesome.
Shani, we were talking a couple of weeks ago on our segment, and we'll call this our What's Cooking segment, sponsored by Manischewitz, the great Manischewitz, the OG in kosher products. Before there was a Heimischer brand, before there was anything else, there was Manischewitz. And you were telling me a really great story about machine-made matzah. Take it away.
Yes. Yes. So first of all, 100%, the OG brand, Manischewitz, is one of the first American kosher food brands. And it all started with Rabbi Dov Ber Manischewitz wanting to make matzah for his community in Cincinnati, Ohio. Now, do you eat square matzah on Pesach?
I absolutely do.
The square matzah that we all familiar on Pesach?
Yeah. Okay. Well, I absolutely do. I have some recipes in my book, matzah toasts that are...
So, matzah toast. The square-made matzah... Before Rabbi Dov Ber Manischewitz, there was no such thing as square-made matzah.
Okay.
He invented square-made matzah, and it was out of necessity. So there were some other, until Manischewitz came around, most matzahs were made by hand. There were some other smaller machine-made matzahs, but they always had a kashrus problem, and the Rabbanim at the time did not give the kosher certification for those smaller machine-made matzahs because they were concerned about the small parts and having dough get into the small parts and having chametz because they were lasting longer.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So Rabbi Dov Ber Manischewitz consulted with many rabbis at the time. He traveled near and far, went to Israel, consulted with rabbis in America, and he invented the three-part matzah baking system that everyone uses today.
Wow.
Yeah, where you have three parts of the machine, one that kneads the dough, one that rolls the dough, and one that perforates and cuts the dough. And the big a big problem they had in the kosher standards was there's leftover cutting the matzah into the circle shape made many leftover scraps, and that those scraps got caught in the machine. So he invented how do you eliminate waste from a circle? You make a square. So he invented the square matzah. He patented the machine. I actually, when I was going through the Manischewitz archives a few years ago, I discovered the original patent for the first machine-made matzah that was universally accepted.
Shani, that is so cool. That is so cool.
I know. I
know. Love that. I love
Jewish
history.
I geeked out when I found it. It's so cool. We eat it, you know, the history lasts to today because we were able to produce a significant amount of matzah because of this. Do you know, can you guess, Naomi, how many pounds of matzah Manischewitz alone, the brand Manischewitz alone, makes a year? Just the matzah.
How many pounds?
How many pounds a year?
I want to say a million.
Over 3 million.
What?
Pounds of matzah.
Wow.
A year. And obviously it could not be done without this kind of machine that all the Rabbanim approved, and it became the standard for matzah eating. You know, we obviously, a lot of us have shmura matzah for seders or even along the whole holiday, but the machine matzah is very widely accepted, and that's its OG origin story, which I think is fascinating.
It's absolutely fascinating. I love it. I love it. I love Jewish history. Like I in college, I always took a lot of Jewish history courses in high school. Whenever I could, whenever I go on a tour of Israel, I'll try to take in as much Jewish history as I can. And learning about like my local Jewish history, you know, American made patterns on matzah. Like that's really cool.
It's like the innovation, ingenuity. I feel like that's something that we should definitely take pride in.
Right. Bringing matzah to the masses. Right?
Exactly.
Think about the Jews in Cincinnati that weren't in Brooklyn or in Kansas. Kansas, I was just there a couple months ago. The Jews in Kansas probably didn't have a matzah factory, and they had to get – and they have a long history of Jews there. They couldn't get matzah, so they probably had to get the Manischewitz matzah. All over the country. We spoke of this a few years ago. Wherever I am in the country, all 48 states I've been to, I've always checked out the kosher aisle, and they've always got Manischewitz products.
And that's where the American brand came from. It's really from him trying to make products for his community and the community at large. Like you said, communities around the country that are not necessarily, you know, they're not insulated by big cosmopolitan cities. They really need to get access kosher food. And you're right, every retailer in the country has Manischewitz products sitting on a shelf.
It's incredible. Can you tell us about... We've heard about some of the old products. Tell us about some of the new products that we can look for this Pesach. We're hearing this first on Shushan Purim.
Shushan Purim. Now we can finally talk about Pesach.
Now
right?
We can talk about Pesach. All the floodgates are open for Pesach talk.
Yeah. So, I mean, what I love about one of the new products we have this year, it's actually it's a old product that has like a little bit of a new take. And we have some chocolate-covered matzahs that I know it sounds – like, oh my gosh, what is that? If you think about a chocolate-covered pretzel, the saltiness, the crispiness, and
the
then it's
sweetness.
And covered in a matzah, the sweetness. We have a gluten-free one. So if you are gluten-free sensitive or aware, it's
keep
totally
it up with the times. That's it.
Exactly. And we have another gluten-free product, a few gluten-free products, actually, that Manischewitz comes out with, because a brand that's synonymous with Pesach, like it is, we come out with gluten-free products as a byproduct, naturally, of trying to come up with products that don't use flour so that we don't have, you know, it's non-gebrox, and we can have products that are naturally gluten-free. So we actually have some great gluten-free products that are kosher for Pesach. We have new gluten-free wafers that taste like the real thing. We have gluten-free pizza in your freezer section that's kosher for Pesach.
Oh,
excellent product.
Shani, can you send me some samples, honey?
Absolutely.
I need samples. We'll cook them up on the show next week.
I'll hand deliver them to you so we
Done.
Can have pizza together.
I'm holding you to it. I mean it. I'll bring out the Betty Crocker.
For all awesome.
For all the people that are making trips on Chol HaMoed. You ready? I lost her.
I'm ready.
Oh, there you go. Okay, there you go. I couldn't hear you there for a second. Okay. All right. Fantastic.
Thank you so much, Naomi.
My pleasure. I'm having it's a little spotty. Is it? Okay. We're good? All right. Shani, thank you so much for coming on the show today. We look forward to
seeing
some of
those. Thank you for
having me. So those, some of those pizza bases, chocolate-coated matzah, hearing the history of the square Manischewitz pattern. I find that mind-blowing. And I would love to see that pattern one day. Will you show me next time we meet up?
Uh-huh. It's in our archives. I have access. I have the key.
Okay. We'll go down to the storage. We'll put on white gloves, white felt gloves when they go down there and, you know, oxygen tanks. Okay. Fantastic. Mm-hmm. Thanks, Sean. We'll talk
thank
soon.
Thank you, Naomi.
All right. Thank you so much for coming on the show. Wow.
My pleasure.
Thank you, Sean. Good Shabbos. Okay. I have to wish a good Shabbos. It's always so cool to hear from her because she always knows like a lot about history because she's been working the kosher food products for a long time. And especially a company like Manischewitz has got like so much history. I didn't even know that they started in Cincinnati, right? Like you think it would start it off in New York, but Cincinnati. Okay. Joining us now, I'm just going to try to get on the phone all in Israel. They are like 7 hours ahead. Here we go. Balagan be gone. Is that a name that I need? I feel like I need to be Balagan. I am a Balagan. Rebecca Saltzman, we knew each other from the Lower East Side days. There's that Israeli ringtone that we all love and we all know, and now the gates the floodgates have opened.
Hello.
Rebecca Saltzman, what up?
Hey, Naomi.
How's it going?
How are you?
Good, good. Can you guys hear?
I'm great. I'm glad to talk to you.
It's been I'd love
to hear your lovely voice.
Thank you. Like back at you. I think we spoke last year before Pesach.
We did.
I think it's going to become an annual thing. I love what you are doing, keeping people organized for Pesach. How was life in the Holy Land first?
Today was a beautiful day. It was nice and sunny and warm. It was really lovely.
Beautiful.
I got to say.
Fantastic. We are recording this show, but everyone is going to listen to it on Shushan Purim.
Excellent.
Friday, right after Purim, and we are just having an amazing time today talking, and we're going to be talking to a great group of people about Pesach talk and just food in general. But let's start off with a good Pesach planning session on Balagan Be Gone.
Okay, I'm ready for you.
How do we start with Pesach? Purim is behind us now. What am I doing? It's like so many people, you know, like it might be their first Pesach, or they, even if they're going away to either Florida or to their in-laws or making – like what? How do you start? Like what's the first thing you need to do to get ready for Pesach?
Okay. So it totally depends on if you're staying or going. In either case, I think that now is a good time to start clearing out your fridge, your freezer, your pantry because
– start with the food. See, guys?
Yeah. I mean, I actually think like cleaning out those spaces gives you two things. If you're making Pesach, then cleaning out those areas gives you space for Pesach food. That's
right.
Number one.
Right.
Number two is if you're not, you will know after Pesach, everything is fresh. So it gives you like Pesach. I always use Pesach as like the holiday, the new year for food for me, because what I do is I know that nothing in my house is really older than last year's Pesach because I'm cleaning out my freezer, I'm cleaning out my pantry, I'm cleaning out my fridge. I use the weeks before Pesach to start using up those open condiments. Maybe I have some chopped vegetables in the freezer. Like those are the, now I'm starting to use up the reserves.
Right. I call it cooking from your pantry. So you
exactly.
just start cooking after Purim, everything that you've got in the house.
Yeah, and it's great. And you can start meal planning around what you already have. It's actually, it sounds like from a budget perspective, it sounds like it might end up costing more. But actually, if you're using up what you have, you reduce your food waste, which is huge. And you'll know that everything after Pesach is fresh. And I feel like it also gives you room for during Pesach. I mean, I have a very small pantry I need the space so that I can, I need to start using the food up so that I can use the pantry space. So
right.
for me, it's practical, but also it really does save time and energy to start using up what you have. And I think it makes you a smarter menu planner for later on because it allows you to see what you really use. And it, yeah. I think, inhibits those impulse purchases in the supermarket later on.
Impulse purchases at the supermarket. I know nothing about that.
I'm sure.
Yeah, yeah. I'm all about the impulse purchases. I'm like, oh, what's that? I've never seen that before. Toss that in the wagon, you know. Never go to the supermarket hungry. Take it from me. So talk about your cookbook, and not your cookbook, your organizing book. I'm holding it up in front of
me. My planner. Oh, the Organized Jewish Life Planner. So it's actually a companion to my book called Organized Jewish Life, which isn't out yet, but the planner is available on Amazon. And that's the next thing you should really be doing if you're staying home for Pesach is now's a great time to start your menu planning and shopping lists because as you start to see things on sale, you can start to pick up dry goods and things like that. And you can start to see what fruits and vegetables are really looking nice and in season. And you can really plan these amazing menus around that. So if you start menu planning with the planner, it will really, really help you. And the nice thing about this planner is that there's tons and tons of checklists in it. And they really, really help you prepare not just your menu planning, but also your budget and your timelines and like all the things related to cleaning for Pesach. But this planner is good for all year round. So there's 52 weeks of Shabbat and there's all the Chagim. So you can use the planner for the whole year and every year you can just swap it out for a new one and just reference the old one.
I'm showing everyone, I'm holding up to the camera our YouTube, on our YouTube channel, on Nachum Segal Net on YouTube. I'm holding up. It's also color coordinated.
Yeah, it's full color.
And you have like things from checklists, what to do on Monday, what to do on Tuesday, Friday afternoon.
Exactly.
Get who the guests are.
So it's easy.
Actually.
Exactly.
I love this part. She has a little box here in orange or red. I'm not sure what color that you would call this. It says date, parsha, what candies and what time Havdalah is. I think that's awesome.
Yeah.
Because I absolutely love this.
It's important to put it down. And at least if you forgot to do that week, you could look back at the week before and, you know, add 5 minutes.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. This is absolutely
or
fantastic.
Or subtract, depending on which way we're going in the calendar.
I love the to-do list. Every day I have a to-do list. I'm a very big to-do list person. I don't know if everyone else
said that. Are you?
I'm getting a nod from Lauren. Yes. Amazing. Where do we pick up your book? Where do we get your book? You live in Israel.
Amazon.
We live in America. Amazon. You can follow
Amazon.
You can follow her on Instagram, Facebook, and your website.
Correct. Balaganbegone.com.
Okay. And on Instagram?
Also, Balagan. It's just Balaganbegone.
Okay. And Facebook?
Same.
Balagan.
Or you can follow me personally, Rebecca Chaffetz Saltzman. Although it's kind of hard to spell.
Right, that is. I know, because I feel like you spell Rebecca differently, and Saltzman has got a Z in it also. So you've got a few Z's in your name.
Search for Balagan, be gone. You'll find me. You'll find me. I'm not hard to find.
Exactly. Wonderful. Thank you so much for coming on. You run a course. Just talk about the course for a quick sec.
Yeah, so it already started. It's a 36-day decluttering challenge to help you get decluttered. But after Pesach, I'll actually be running a paper decluttering challenge. So Ooh. If you are interested in that, you can send me a DM and I'll be happy to send an email about that.
Love it. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Rebecca, it's always great to talk to you.
Love talking to you, Naomi.
From the Lower East Side days where we both used to live in Seward Park. To you're
yes,
in Israel. I hope to join you one day, but I'm in New York.
We hope that you join us soon too.
Amen, amen. Okay, great. I want to say have a good Shabbos. I don't have to say Happy Purim anymore. Right? It's Happy Shushan Purim. Okay, have a good Shabbos.
Have a happy and kosher Pesach.
And a happy, exactly, kosher Pesach. Thank you, Rebecca. All right.
Thanks for having me, Naomi.
My pleasure. All right, guys, you got to get this book, Rebecca. Okay, I'm gonna hang up. Okay. Okay, now I don't have to like bring in the guests. All right, on the phone, all our guests are in person now. Susie's like, oh my God, Naomi, what? Are you nervous, Susie?
No, I just want to go cook in the kitchen.
I know. I pulled Susie out of the kitchen. We'll talk about the guest lineup in a second. So right next to me, I have Lauren Duran Jamal. But next to her is Chef Susie Gornish and then restaurateur extraordinaire, my good friend Moshe Hirsch from Central Perk. Susie and I run a Pesach business together. We were introduced by the great Bosch Boschneck, right?
That's right.
And we have been cooking together for about 4 years.
4 years.
There you go. You've got a handheld mic.
Woohoo.
I know. You feel like you want to sing when you've got that in your hand, right? Yeah. So we're going to talk to Lauren first, and we're going to hear about her knife skills. And Susie's definitely going to jump in on this because she's actually trained by the Culinary Institute of America. And then Moshe will talk too. But really, how are you?
Hi, Naomi. Thank you so much for having me.
My pleasure.
I'm so excited to be here.
I'm very excited to have you on the show. So a couple of weeks ago, your aunt reached out to me and said, Naomi, would you like to try a new knife? And I'm like, sure. I get a lot of here. Put your microphone. Put this. Just raise it up.
Better? Okay.
Better?
Great.
Good. Would you like to try a new knife? I'm always looking to try new knives. I find knives don't always stay sharp for so long, right? It's a big problem.
Yeah, for sure.
So I'm like, sure. So this, of course, I didn't remember the conversation. I told you this. And I'm like, all of a sudden, like 3 weeks later,
right,
a knife shows up. I'm like, did I order one on Amazon? Like, as you get older, you think you're starting to lose it.
Definitely.
And then your aunt followed up. I'm like, oh, now it all comes together. And here you are on the show. We spoke. I'm going to open up the box. This is my knife that you sent
me. Think outside the plate, chef's knife, 8-inch chef's knife. That's my brand name.
And how did you, a young lady in college, to become a
registered dietitian,
an RD, the real thing?
Yeah.
The real thing.
Yep.
Come up with a knife company. Look at this. I'm going to take it out of this beautiful box.
It's untouched. Wow.
Yeah,
yours is beautiful. Mine's still, I don't know, I feel like I've had mine for so long. I'm like eager to open
that's
a new
okay.
one.
It's okay. It's good. Yeah. It's good. Okay. And it comes with a little knife safety thing. Mm-hmm. Okay. So how did you get into this?
So how did I get into it? I was always passionate about cooking. It was one of my favorite things to do growing up as a child. And when I started my undergraduate degree at NYU, studying nutrition and dietetics, we had our first course, which was Introduction to Foods and Food Science. And one of the first things we learned in the kitchen was knife skills. And I thought to myself, like, wow. I said I felt so empowered carrying something as heavy as 8 inches and pasting something as little as a garlic. And it was very – it gave me a lot of confidence. And so I think that was like sort of – I said to myself, like, this really is an underrated skill that people need to know more of. And I felt like it was missing in my community, especially we have such strong ties to, and I'm sure everybody has a big heritage to a culinary background in Syria.
Are you Syrian?
I'm a Syrian Jew, yes.
Brooklyn? Deal?
I live in Brooklyn, I do. I'm in Jersey for the summers, so it's great. I get the double balance. And then the following 2 years later, I began teaching cooking classes. And I had one steady group of students. I remember going to one of my local stores to pick up knives. And I just remember looking through the shelves and, like, they have no good quality knives. Like, I think that's what sort of planted the seeds for me. And fast forward, I started to teach my classes, teaching knife skills. And I'm teaching them the rowboat technique, holding the knife and how to use it.
What's it called? Rowboat?
So, yeah, the way that I was taught is you sort of take your index finger and your thumb and you wrap it around the knife.
Okay, I'm doing this. Everyone stop what you're doing who's listening. Grab your knife. It's Erev Shabbos. I know you're cooking. Let's do some knife skills.
Just, can I stand up?
Yeah, sure.
You're just going to row the bowl like that. So if you want to, do you want to try
yeah,
something?
Yeah, can I do it? Can I stand up?
For sure.
Oh, we're going to jump right into it. So you wanted a knife to help you with knife skills.
So yeah, so I had one of my students.
Okay,
she looked at me.
Oh, this is fun.
She said, I want a knife. And I said, okay, no problem. I'll send you the Amazon link. I think it was like a Wusthof knife. And she said, we're going to cut this lengthwise. Maybe take off the safety thing.
Oh, yeah.
And I said, no problem. I'll send you the Amazon link. And she's like, nope. I want to order this knife from you. And fast forward, I was on Zoom.
So what
for
I
school.
Do like this?
So we're going to make a basic Italian tomato salad. And then I'm just going to cut them.
Oh, we're actually making a salad?
Yeah. We're going to –
Oh, that's great.
Very
I love
easy.
Tomato and basil. Yeah. You got my two favorite foods.
Yeah, so tomato, basil, and shallots. And then I have some red wine vinegar, mustard, and olea essence olive oil. That's my dad's. He sells
Is this
going to
be parf?
Yes.
Oh, fantastic.
Lily Parv. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay, cool.
I'm not all about that.
Okay.
And so I was also the other... Yeah, you got it. So in this hand, you're sort of pinching the knife, and then in the opposite hand, you're tucking your thumb in.
Am I holding it right?
Yeah, of course. I mean, you, you're the professional here. And they always say, like, if a knife goes through a tomato, that's when you know it's good quality. So that I started off with the tomato just to help you out. So I'm just going to cut this lengthwise.
This is great. So what
There's
am I
no
doing?
There's no particular way. And I think we're just going to put it in the bowl because I meant to bring bowls.
Okay. Lucky I have a lot of plastic bowls.
Yes, thank God.
Okay.
Perfect.
Wow, this is a really good knife. And by the way, that's a really nice tomato.
I'm so happy. It's a Roma tomato.
Okay, Roma.
And if you guys want to find this recipe, it's on my website.
Okay, which is?
Think-outsidetheplate.com.
Think-outsidetheplate.com.
Yes. Okay, so fast forward when I was on school for Zoom, I was getting a little relentless. I really always need simulation. I got my bartending license like the semester before, and when I found out...
Wait, there's actually something real for bartending?
Yeah, of course.
I wonder if all those guys, license. I wonder if all those guys that have, you know, those businesses have got a bartending license. No, like we had the Kagans.
They have
I had
to.
Jake from last 2 weeks
I
ago.
Mean, I think if you're teaching like individually at homes, maybe not. It's not as formal, but I'm sure like if you're working at a bar,
tomato.
You definitely need it. Taste it. Let me know. Amen. Mmm. It's yummy, right?
Really
it's very fresh.
Tomato.
Yeah. I really only like tomatoes when I grow them in my garden, which it's wintertime, so it's not the time.
August, baby.
August.
I have a whole thing outside.
Yeah, I'm so excited. And okay. It was come November. I found out that I had Zoom school the following semester, and I came home one day, and I looked at my dad, because he's in the industry, and I was like, Dad, I want a manufacturer knife. And he's like, leave me alone. I have too much on my plate right now. I don't want to deal with this. And, you know, while
I'm
talking.
What does your dad do?
He sells appliances, so kitchen appliances. So it was sort of like an easier connection for me, but he didn't help me. it happens to be that every time he comes home from work, he's always just showing me some portfolios and asking me if I think something is like a profitable item. And one day he came home about like 2 weeks after I asked him this, showing me some plates and pots and pans and things, and I remember flipping through the portfolio and I spotted chef's knives. And at the time, I was trying to source a few factories like in Japan and Germany. And as I'm flipping through, I see like this little corner of the factory's information. So I just took a little picture of it.
Good job.
Hi. Little devious of me. And I reached out to the factory, and the rest was history. And so it's been a long yet fulfilling journey. And now I incorporate knife skills into all my cooking classes.
I do have a question for you.
Ask away.
Susie, take the microphone.
Take it.
I have a question for you. So when you found the manufacturer that you decided you wanted to go with, how did you decide how you wanted to design the knife?
Oh, that's a very good question. It's a very good question.
Thanks, Susie. Great question.
Yeah, I actually had this vision. I wish I brought that sample, but I had this vision, a very sleek vision of what I wanted my knife to be to align with my brand. I wanted this black, straighter knife that was a chef's knife, but also very functional. And I got samples, sample after sample. I'm noticing that I sent it to a few chefs to ask them their opinion. And I started noticing that in comparison from one of my samples to that one, it was scratching easily. The sharpness didn't stay. The edge retention, yeah, sorry. And I spoke to a chef, shout out to Kim Kushner. I remember.
We love Kim.
Yeah,
Kim has
I love
been
her
on the
too.
Show a few times, and I can't wait for her next book.
She's really unbelievable. I'm so excited for her next book. And I basically had a phone call with her, and she looked at me. I mean, she didn't look at me, but she said very firmly on the phone, Lauren, there is a reason why stainless steel chef's knives have been around for hundreds of years. It's just, there's a reason why. And, you know, I sort of had to let go of that vision of that sleek thing that I wanted to align with my brand and say, you know what, is it functionality that I'm going for, or is it just looks, you know? So I sort of, it was like a little battle in my head, but you know what, at the end of the day, I'm very proud and happy of what I introduced. And I think most of my market doesn't really, they don't know much about chef's knives. So it was sort of okay for me to start with this. And yeah, so here I am.
How about what I'm asking you, I think, is also about the shape and the design of the knife.
So yeah, so good question. I tried a few samples And I wasn't really so particular about, like, the bolster and the anatomy of the knife. It was more so the functionality that I got with it. And when I brought it to people, because I by no means consider myself, like, a professional chef, I'm going to show you what I mean by it. So the next knife skill I'm going to teach you guys is a chiffonade. I love
Which is a technique in cutting fresh herbs. Susie is a culinary chef trained.
Am I crazy? Like, I say when I teach classes, I love chiffonading romaine lettuce because I feel like it applies. It's another word for shredding in my head.
Right. Can I just tell you one thing about we like our romaine lettuce cut into ribbons in my house.
Really?
Not torn. I know you're supposed to tear it, right, Susie?
No, I do both.
Are you?
Okay. I like it cut, like, in fine ribbons. My daughter's
that's exactly.
Simi.
So shredded. Very thin,
like
and fine.
Like a cabbage, right? You're
yeah.
saying?
Right. Exactly
like a
cabbage.
Like a chiffonade. Mm-hmm.
So is it fair of me to say that I consider this a chiffonade? Okay, good.
Right,
yes.
So I'm going to do a little chiffonade basil.
Which is when you stack layers of, say, basil on top of each other.
Could
then
you see
roll
it
up. Not everyone can see some.
Oh,
talking
okay,
everyone through it. You roll and I'll talk. You stack layers of basil leaves. You roll it up lengthwise. And then you cut. You make a stack. It's almost like you're rolling. It looks like you're rolling a cigarette almost.
Yeah.
And then you
roll the boat.
And then you row. What do you call it?
Row the boat. Yeah.
Row the boat. Is that the term of art or that's your term?
Yep. I'm rowing the boat.
We just back. I call it rock chop where you just rock it back and forth. In a slow sliding motion as well.
And also a big thing about it is that I never let the knife lift off of the board.
I taught that last night.
Yeah, so the tip is just always moving. And here, it's just like a beautiful, it's just like a beautiful shred.
Very
nice. If you could see it. And then what I'm going to do is just put it in the salad.
Yeah.
Should probably start making the dressing.
I feel like it's the summer now.
It's a great, I serve this all the time. And I'm just going to put a little red wine vinegar. It's really, you know what I do sometimes when I make this out? If I want some time in advance, I'll slice up the shallots and let it just marinate in the olive oil and the vinegar, which I didn't have time for today. But
it a quick like pickle beforehand.
Yeah.
I think people don't really use shallots as much as they should.
They don't?
I'm a real shallot person.
Then.
Well, shallots, Susie, you have a background in French cooking,
I'm just saying, shallots are like a little bit of a milder. They're good for salads and dressings.
Yeah.
And they're also good for like a very fine sauce that you don't want so oniony.
I call it a cousin of
sweet.
An onion.
It's very sweet. And, you know, my little trick that I tell people all the time is that when you're wearing contacts, you won't cry. If you wear contact lenses, you will not cry from onions.
Right. I don't wear contacts, so I cry.
Yeah, so. I always wondered.
We all cry at motions.
You know, I always wondered why I never cried when I chopped up onions. And then one day I just decided to wear my glasses and I was hysterical crying. And I was like, oh, that's probably it, you know?
Yeah.
And I'm just going to do another basic slice. I want to show you guys another trick, another skill.
Yeah, we love to learning tricks.
Yeah, so I'm just going to, this is my basic slice. My slice shallots.
Look how nicely she's. I can't see from this angle, but it looks like you're holding it nicely.
Could
you've
you
got
see
that
it?
Yeah. Knuckle protecting
the rest
of your hand.
So my knuckle always
your guide.
Your knuckle can be touching the knife. That prevents you from getting hurt. And this is also like basically like a half moon slice, I would say, in an onion form. Just because if I had another,
do you know all the different knife cuts like Brunoise?
So I know Brunoise. Yeah, I don't consider myself like a pro. I'm not as like quick and equipped with a lot of it, but I do know it. I love it. I teach it all the time. But Brunoise is just a basic word for finely diced, right? Am I right?
Brunoise is a little bit bigger than a fine dice.
Is it? Okay.
A little bit bigger.
A little bit bigger than a fine dice.
See, it's a little more technical.
Just a tiny, but it's all right.
Okay.
So we have some sea salt, maybe?
You don't have salt.
I thought I brought it out.
Okay. Here. Should I grab some salt? You talk. I'll grab the salt.
Yeah, so here I just have my delicious shallot and tomato salad with basil. Maybe salt and pepper would make it very yummy. Yeah, perfect. I only use Himalayan salt, actually. The minerals are much healthier for metabolism. That's my dietetic background.
I can't sense EK rummaging through the closet.
Can we serve this in Central Park today?
Yes.
Can you? Please
you
do.
You have good tomatoes.
Let me know how you like it. You know what? Let's make a few bowls of it so you guys can all
it's
try it.
It's looking pretty good.
Yeah. Looks good, right? You know what, Moshi? Sometimes a simple salad speaks for itself. A little
really,
feta cheese on top
really,
of that.
It really, really, really does.
Some radish.
The simpler, the better.
Yeah.
The simpler, the better. And you know what? I think I learned that as I planted gardens over the summers, that It's really.
Wait, you want me to help? You go. She's got this. She's got this.
I don't want to burden you with it, but probably should mix a little bit. Yeah. So that's
very nice.
Yeah, it's really like an easy, delicious salad. Just put that one in. I think, you know what? I'm just warning you, the shallots, I usually like it to marinate a little longer.
Oh,
so
that's okay.
It doesn't taste as great.
You had
great.
Me at tomatoes. I'm good with
okay,
tomatoes.
Okay, fine. I'm happy. And really, I love like just the basil in it. I think that's like the most important thing in it. Okay.
Okay.
Maybe add a little of this. Let me know what you think.
A little bit. Yeah, I love vinegar.
I love vinegar.
Acids.
I love.
Lemon and balsamic.
Give me all of it. Any salad, I'm sold.
Okay, so this is for me. We're going to serve Central Perk some salad today.
Okay. I'll take it from the critic himself.
Mm. Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Do you have forks over there?
Mm.
Awesome.
It's enough.
Yeah, all right. You're fast.
In the meantime, I also prepared, you guys can taste it in the meantime, my vegan Caesar kale salad. You can also find this recipe on my website as well. It's really delicious, but I'm gonna get another cutting board for this because I just want a clean surface.
There's a whole setup here.
Yeah. Yeah. So I definitely came prepared.
You have your board, your vegetables all cut up. Yeah, I think we need like a 3-hour supersize show.
Oh my goodness. So I teach cooking classes. So normally this is what it is. I began teaching virtual during COVID.
Yeah, I did a lot of Zoom classes.
Yeah, me too. Yeah, you know what? It opened up a market.
Oh, I don't mind. I kept me busy from going crazy. Moishe and I,
likewise,
we hustled our way through 2020.
Yeah.
Right?
So
we sold eggs. We sold food. We did Zoom. Look, Moishe, 2 years later, we got out of this.
Yeah, thank God.
Thank God. You putting the tent up again?
As of now, the village of Cedars is not allowing it.
And really? How come?
They're all gone. The one from Gomme Glatt Parking Lot.
It looks like the city is getting the permits back.
For outdoor seating?
For outdoor seating.
Wow.
Yeah.
It's smart.
Yeah. You know what they said last year? There was no accidents with any propane. So why wouldn't they let it continue?
Yeah, why not?
So here I have some kale salad. So I just finally spiced some jalapeno. I do. I made this yesterday. Mm-hmm.
Oh, good. We like a good soaked massage kale. Yeah. I like a massage also.
Yeah, likewise. So it's you know what? It's so the cell wall breaks down when you cook it. I'm sorry, when you massage it a day before, which is really important, I think, with kale because also it's not easily digested for most people.
Yeah, it's a bit rough. I remember the first time I had kale, it was very rough on the belly, but I'm not a jalapeno person.
Oh, you're not? Okay, yours won't get jalapeno.
What's it called? What's the Ashkenazi called?
You're not from Syria.
No.
You're not spicy. You don't like spicy.
I'm not spicy,
but I love jalapenos.
What do Syrians call Ashkenazis? J-dub?
Oh, I know that term, J-dub. But
I don't know what it really means.
I think it just means Ashkenaz. I don't really know either.
Yeah, me either. Because I don't know. But what is that on top?
So it's cashew croutons. Mm. I have another one for you. I'm going to give you yours without jalapenos. But so this is for Central Park.
Okay, ZK's like, you know,
do you want some?
He's not really a salad guy.
Do you want
try.
Some?
ZK
are you gonna try
drinks
it?
Drinks with me every week.
Okay.
Can you move the kale? Cause ZK.
Yeah. So I was gonna chop some extra.
That's my clock.
Yes. Go for it.
Yeah. Okay. Or else I'll be talking for 3 hours if I
goodness.
Didn't have that
okay,
clock.
Okay. So this is yours.
Moishe, is it fun to have someone else cook for you?
Of course, I love it. Sitting back and watching this.
So are you a chef at home?
No.
Most of the time?
My wife says I'm the best helper when I stay out of the kitchen.
I have to agree with her.
My husband
do you want?
Also.
Okay. Mm. What do we think?
It's delicious.
Okay.
What knife skills are involved in cutting up the kale?
So the kale, so it's chopping up some kale, chopping a fine chop, a rough chop, I would say, and then a thinly sliced jalapeno. I also wanted to show you guys a julienne. I think that's also an important one, and pasting, and then I'll get out of your way.
You can tell that she's farty because she's just like haphazardly throwing those jalapenos around without washing her hands.
Oh, it does not burn. It does not even affect me.
Also, you see
maybe because you had it from birth. There. Microphone, Susie.
You have that shallot there?
Yes.
Can you give us a little dice on the shallot?
Yes. So I actually wanted to. I have another knife to use, but I'm sure you guys want
I have a knife over here.
Hey, yeah.
You can use that same knife.
Okay. I like to rinse.
Is that mine?
I think this one's yours. Yeah.
Yes, it is.
Well, okay. So the way that I dice is I make fine little incisions through the bottom. Can you see it? Let's take that away.
Is that the front or the back of the shallot?
This is the front.
I like to keep my skin on when I do that, to keep the root tip intact.
Yeah, yeah. I think everyone has their own way as they go. So I do about like three or four.
You got to do what works for you.
Exactly.
In your comfort zone. We talk about that a lot on this show. Wine pairings and cut. You do what works. You drink what you like. You cut how what you like. There's no right or wrong.
I think like the world now, society is moving less towards formality. So I'm very by the book. I'm very into education. I think it's very important to have that background. But I think as you go, it's okay to form your own style. So I do like about three or four. And I think everybody teaches things differently. You know what I mean?
No,
it's like it's
we do
broken
a very
telephone.
Similar.
And then I do like, again, taking the tip of the knife. So as you see, this knife has like a lot of different functions in terms of what part of the knife you're using for a certain type of cut.
Really?
So say like for, 100%. I mean, I think most knives, like for a julienne, I think I would use sort of like the middle to the bottom, and for the top of the onion,
as
shallot.
She's touching the tip of the knife, I'm wincing because it's a sharp knife.
I have my sagas with cutting my hands. It's not even from knives anymore. Okay, so ready again. I'm going to do the rowboat technique. And this is my fine dice. And with onions, it's a little less like cleaner and even as of a cut because you're just chopping it up after.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like that, if you're dicing a carrot, it's going to be a little more even.
And we never, ever scrape our board with the edge of our knife. We turn our knife
over. Never.
Like that. See, I don't do that. I turn it over and I scrape it.
Yeah.
Susie knows I cringe.
I know, but I don't do that with my knife. I use it. Everybody should be able to use their knife the way they like.
Yeah, exactly. Yes. But I don't want anyone using my knives like that.
So if you see
using
like
my knife,
yes.
You have to turn it over.
Yes. So if you see now like another way that I'm using the knife is that once I start chopping, you see how my hands like I'm no longer it's a different technique now, you know? So this is a finely diced shallot. The wires like under my cutting board, but yeah, so this is could you see it in the camera?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
She did a really good job there, everyone.
Very
give
nice.
Her a round of applause.
Thank you. Okay, and then the last thing I think
show
I wanted to
thing.
Show you guys. Yeah, and if you want any extra dressing to dip things.
Oh, yeah, no, I'm really enjoying this, both of them.
So I have actually two more, but if we don't have time for it, it's totally fine. Okay. So I think I'm going to go with a julienne or a paste. What do you think?
A julienne.
Or
a paste.
Pasting garlic?
Do julienne.
Okay.
So, it's more practical.
Yeah. So I always love teaching pasting, though, because it was my great-grandfather's favorite knife skill, and it's also mine, and I didn't know that. It was more of intuition. Like, I always
That's
said
so
I loved
funny.
It, and
well,
my grandma told
I'm going to make you come back
me.
On my show. That's
okay,
all.
Okay. Yeah. I'm good. So what we do with the julienne is now I sort of just slice it
unless
in the middle.
You can do both quickly.
I definitely can.
Okay. Then
do And with a julienne, it's similar to like a slice. You want to have even ends, but for me, like if I'm making French fries, this is a potato. I use these ends for the fries because I don't necessarily care about evenness, like we said.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone finds their own style. But in terms, for purposes of this knife skill, I'm just going to show you how I was taught. So I sort of find, I slice it down until I get an even area on the potato, right? And then what I do is I thinly slice through the potato, and I'll take like let's say three of these. It's not as even as I want it to be, but it's okay.
Oh, it looks fantastic.
Still gonna give me
that's still very nice.
Type A in me. You're still gonna get that julienne feel, and then again, just holding it down.
Like matchsticks. Julienne is French word, and it's like matchsticks.
Yeah.
Yeah, matchstick slices.
Okay, and then this is what you're left with. And they're great for like stir fries and things like that.
Let's do the smash.
Okay, so let's do the paste.
Because I got to talk to Moishi and
you're
Susie.
You're fine, I know. I don't want to keep you all day. So this
I could
is,
stand here talking all day with you.
This is my shout out to Phantom Chef. I collaborate with them all the time.
Oh, I do stuff
some,
with them also.
They're the best.
I love their pots and pans. I should have them on the show with you.
You should. You really should. I actually
you
love
them.
You
talk to Jonathan?
I spoke to Zeev and I speak with Flo, the social media coordinator.
Oh, I
and
speak
Sarah.
To Jonathan. Okay.
So they're great. They send me their things to test out, and I love what they do. And I actually spoke with them yesterday. I said, do you want me to bring him some cutting boards? So here I am. Okay, so here we are pasting a garlic. So what you're going to do with the garlic is always have salt next to you, right? Mm. So if you see this, the first thing that you do, I love this because it's so therapeutic.
You just smash.
Take the knife.
Watch.
And then you just smash the garlic.
Bad garlic. Bad.
It's great. You let out a lot of aggression. And then I'm just going to take some salt. And then you're just going to chop up the garlic first. So chop.
I remember doing this when I went to culinary school for the summer one year. 6 years ago at CKCA.
So if you're doing a lot of garlic, I guess the shortcut is using a mortar and pestle, but I personally find it very therapeutic to use the knife. You're cringing.
I cannot handle when the edges scratch.
I know.
Keep those. I'm telling you, there's a big difference when you don't scrape the knife edge.
So like that. That's how you do it. Well, how do you do it? Can you show me?
I turn the knife over because I don't want to ruin that edge. I go like this.
That's too much time for me.
Yeah, it's a lot of time sometimes. It's a lot of time. I mean, I'll try.
My knives are too precious.
Yeah, you're very.
I was saving this for Pesach. Does that mean I can't use it for Pesach?
I'm hoping Lauren's going to send me one for Pesach.
So you can get one. Yes. I don't know halacha.
No, I'm not.
But I think you could. I think you could do that. That kosher flip, you know that when you kosher your utensils?
Yeah, kosher, when you kosher for Pesach. but I don't know. No, I think it's got this, so I'm.
Yeah.
I cook for other people, so I'm very strict.
Yeah, that's okay. So now, as you see, I'm pasting the garlic towards me. And the salt, what it does is that it lets out a lot of water. And then we're just going to paste.
Paste means cut.
Yeah, till it becomes like a pasty texture and you put it on some garlic bread or some fish and it's like very liquidy.
So she's chopping it off. Fantastic.
Mincing, yeah.
So this is, it's a mince, but then it turns into a paste because I'm adding the salt.
Gotcha.
It makes it into
Susie's
like a.
Susie's like, I've done this.
I'm just checking with her.
Everybody's... Oh, you're testing me?
No, I'm checking with you.
I'm up for the challenge.
No, I'm checking in with you.
She's checking in with you, not testing.
No, I'm not testing you. You're doing a great job.
Moshi, she can work for you.
I'll take it.
I think I'm ready to hire her.
Okay. Let me know your hours.
Knife skills.
So if
6 a.m. report to Cedarhurst.
6 a.m. I don't know if I can be up that early. Let's.
Well, she's already
there teaching them how to do this.
Exactly. I could teach. That. I'll feel more comfortable teaching.
They've got to want to learn. It's very hard to learn new tricks, you know?
It is. It's definitely hard. It took me time, and I don't consider myself a pro at this point in my life.
Thank you so much for sharing that with us. Let's talk to Moshi now. You can keep chopping. You'll stick around.
I'm here, chopping
and talking with us. Moshi Hirsch, welcome to the show.
Welcome.
Okay, you having a good time?
We know each other for many years.
I know, since I moved in.
And I finally got onto the show.
You know why? Because I'm now here in the house. Since Corona, we're here in the house. But it's really nice to have you. I love Central Perk. You know, I'm there all the time. How long have you had the restaurant for?
We're coming on to 20 years.
Amazing.
Wow.
Yeah,
a long time.
We signed the lease over 20 years ago, but it took us about 8 months to get it open, and we're coming up there.
Ah, fantastic. Now tell me, being in the restaurant business for 20 years is like 100 years in the real world. Like, not that many restaurants last that long. Do you feel like
it's been a long ride? It's been a good ride.
And you worked so hard during Corona. You kept everyone in the neighborhood fed. You kept your family fed. You know, all of us.
We do what we got to do. But it also, like we said earlier here, it created a lot of opportunities.
Yeah, absolutely. I love that you had the restaurant out the back.
Yeah, we had the outside, we had the tent up, we had outdoor seating. Now we gradually moved over into, first we went onto third-party apps because it was much easier that way to get food delivered efficiently.
What do you mean by third-party app? Explain to the listeners.
What happens is, I'll give you a little background. It started many years ago, about 20 years ago, Seamless started in the city.
My husband had it. When he was in a law firm.
Correct. And the point of Seamless was called a third-party billing, meaning if it was a law firm and then you went and you needed to take a client to lunch, then there had to be accounting for it. You had to go get it approved. You had to go – you know, there was a lot of paperwork involved. Seamless did was
– They made it seamless.
They made it seamless that you called in the order through them. You called them, you had a lunch. They built the firm for you. They had a list of restaurants, and they used to send the order via fax to the restaurants. That's how it was. It was a dedicated fax machine that was signed to every restaurant. And that got, then the app business got created, because what happened was that if you want deliveries, and let's use the Five Towns for example. And if we, on a quiet day, if we had, let's say, two deliveries going out, but one was going to Hewlett and one was going to Farakway, and if we sent Hewlett first, the person in Farakway could wait up to 30 minutes to 45 minutes after the food is ready to get the food.
Correct.
And it got cold. They seamless merged together with, excuse me, with Grubhub. And Grubhub created that. That's how it was. Grubhub went and bought Seamless out, since Seamless was very big in New York. And they created this app that drivers would come pick up, and they can send, if you had 20 orders, it made no difference. Because if you had two orders going to Hewlett, they would send one driver, take two orders to Hewlett, at the same time send a driver going to Northwood Mare with another driver going to Farakway. So the concept of ordering became very easy.
So this is really, but you don't have so many orders out of the Five Towns, right? Or you do?
It's in a certain amount. Well, it works with how long it takes to get delivery. It depends on the traffic.
Uh-huh.
With how the range of availability is.
Uh-huh.
So now, once this got created, it came to COVID, this concept became on steroids because everybody was ordering food.
Yeah.
Okay, so now the way these app companies make money is they charge a percentage to the restaurant. They charge 30% to the restaurant, and then they also double dip, meaning they charge the customer 15% more on the food. Now the restaurant can't afford a 30% hit, so what do? They raise the price. So now an average customer is paying an average between 20 and 40% more per order when you order on an app.
In general. Now. Okay, so how are you?
Now we fast forwarded this and we created this concept that we signed the contract. Central Perk signed the contract with DoorDash to do our deliveries.
Uh-huh.
So we brought in this company called Toast Tab.
Yeah.
And you can order and it acts exactly like an app. It works exactly like an app. It remembers your last order. It remembers everything on it. You place an order on it. It seamlessly comes right into us through our system. And DoorDash sends a cart to pick up the food and deliver it. Now, how does DoorDash make money? DoorDash charges us $7.50 a delivery plus a subscription every month.
Yeah.
So the Wall Street Journal had a whole article. I mean, it's a statistic article about stats, how it works.
Yeah.
That with paying $7 an order, with paying $7, an average order over $40, you save 30%. With paying the $7 delivery fee, since you're not paying any percentage
and
any service fees to the third-party apps, for Uber Eats, for DoorDash. And the customers always say, why don't you just tell them, you don't want to get ripped off, order this way. But if you're used to a certain concept, here, this concept, now we cut out the third-party apps. You can order directly through the restaurant. And we created a button on our Instagram page. You can go to our Instagram page, which is obviously you...
Can I show everyone?
Sure.
Hold on. I'm just going to go to Instagram, your Instagram. Oh, no. Okay, hold on. Sorry, everyone. I'm pulling up Perk Central because I thought this was great, Perk Central. And straight onto Instagram, we're using my phone, you can do order food.
Correct.
And I have used it. I am testifying that this is a fantastic use of the way to order. Usually I just drive down there and say, hi, Moishi, and I order food that way. But when I don't have a chance, and when I was home with Corona back in December, I was dying for an Impossible Burger. And I ordered through the app, and it was absolutely fantastic. And it came.
And now we brought Chef Susie on board.
Now we talk to Chef Susie. Hey, Susie.
Hey, I'm awake now.
Susie, how are you? Susie's always awake. Susie is a partner in crime with me. She's a chef trained at the Culinary Institute of America. She, Bal Tshuva, with an amazing journey of finding Yiddishkeit with her teenage daughter, how they became from together. She married a wonderful man. They have a little boy who's at Yeshiva South Shore. We were introduced about 5 years ago. We were talking, let's say, four years ago.
This will be our fifth year.
But we call him Bosh Bosh Neck, if you know. He's been on the show a couple months ago. Uh-huh. And we have been cooking together. Even though it's Aussie Gourmet, it's really...
And we stole Susie from you, I guess.
No, no, we share. We share custody of the child. And Susie and I are partners in crime on my Pesach business. Even though it says Aussie Gourmet, it really should be the Aussie Susie Gourmet. But Susie has a lot of techniques and stuff that I didn't know because, you know, I didn't really go to chef school. And she's bringing a world of the outside world that she learned and trained in into the kosher world. So welcome, Susie.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on.
Our pleasure. It's been fun working with Moshe.
Absolutely. We've been working together for about 2 years off and on. I help Moshe with some new items, just trying
you
to
help
like,
my crew, not
well,
just me.
I help
the whole staff.
I think outside the dots a little bit with my old like non-from world. And like I have a palette that kind of... you know, is able to like help out with what new concepts, new flavors, which we came up with this Connie Rangoon. Now, Rangoon is like been around for ages. It was
what food is it? What
it's
cuisine?
It's American, if you could imagine, Chinese American. It was made from Trader Vic's. It was a restaurant back in San Francisco back in the 60s, 70s, I guess. And they constructed this particular sort of item. All Chinese restaurants, you go in there, they serve you a sort of fake crab cream cheese wonton. So here we have...
Our own version of that.
I created these for Moshe and for Central Perk, and it's basically a nice jalapeno and ginger.
Can I just say what it is? It's delicious. She's going to describe it. It is delicious. Moshe sent me some over to try as a sample. I was supposed to share it with a bunch of people, foodies that were together. I ate it before everyone got there because I could not stop eating it. It is amazing. Amazing. I love it.
So I really... you know, thought this would be a great item for your menu and, you know, fun, exciting.
It's been a big hit.
And, it's a huge hit. Everyone loves it.
The guys don't like when I come to work there so much because they're like, uh-oh, more work. Oh, Susie's here. Uh-oh.
But it's good. Susie, tell us a little bit about your background. Where did you work before this? Give us a little bit about that CV that you showed me before.
Oh, my resume. Anyway, I... really started with when I was about 15, 16, loving food. My mother was a great cook, Olive Shalom, and she was a professional artist. And so I think a lot of what my sort of food and artistic ability came from traveling as a young child and going to a lot of high-end restaurants as a child, like 4 or 5 years old.
Like my Leora Nachman.
I mean, like, you know, really fancy restaurants. My parents traveled a lot. They took us all over the world. We went to a restaurant, Le Soufflé in Paris. And so I got a real, like, appreciation for food. And wine. I hated wine when I was little, but then I sort of realized that food and wine are so like
a natural pairing. Yeah.
So I decided after I was really into cooking all through my high school years, and then I decided to go to the Culinary Institute of America. I wasn't a very good student in high school, but once I got to the Culinary Institute, I was
a shining star, top
in my class. I worked, made croissants on the weekends as a extracurricular thing, and then I after cooking school, I hooked up at Suwanika Yacht Club in Oyster Bay, which was crazy. But it did. It was sort of one of those things where you sort of, once you come out of cooking school, you're not a chef. You have to, you know, you sort of have to work from the bottom up. And sometimes you don't really know that as a young person. But it's trial and tribulations all through your careers. But I ended up, my mother was, again, a famous artist. And she knew a lot of people in Europe. So I was able to go an apprentice in Belgium at a Michelin 2-star restaurant. So that really jump-started my career as like really like very systematic, like, you know, culinary. It's a regime, a French kitchen. And everybody, I mean, it's really like the saucier and the garmager and the pâtissier. And I mean,
now explain that to everyone who has no clue what a blah, 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 and a blah,
so,
blah, blah.
So
you
all
know?
These are really very classic French terminologies for each person that like works into a kitchen, like a sommelier, like a wine person that learns how to wine and food pair. So it's
breaking down the kitchen, and everybody's got their exact job.
Yes.
From the saucier to the garmager, which is the prep, vegetable prep, to the sauce prep,
also,
to the grill prep. Everything works in a line, and that's why working on the line is like when you hear someone working on a line in a restaurant, they've got their position.
So I was friends with the chef, and I lived right there in the heart of the city in a little tiny little room. And but I really flourished and like learned as much as I could and traveled, and I worked in a Belgian chocolate store.
Was the transition hard to go from not kosher to kosher when you became frum?
Well, I had a lot of knowledge of frumkeit, let's say.
Because you grew up in a traditional?
We went to the synagogue twice a year.
Okay.
Whatever.
She goes every week.
My parents were kept kosher when I was little, when my grandparents were alive. And my cousins were religious. So I would go to their house for Shabbos, and I would drive there and go home. But yeah, I don't think it was so hard transitioning, because I really knew the idea of meat and dairy. But and it wasn't that hard. I think just koshering the kitchen and knowing that I couldn't bring anything else in.
So you had to like really like work hard to like, if you had something that wasn't kosher and you loved that flavor, did you have to work hard to try to bring that into the kosher recipe?
So I did have a hard time transitioning from not necessarily into my own home. I have like destination places that I go. I go to Patisse for bread. I go to, you know, Glotmart for meat. And Gourmet Glot too, but...
Of course Gourmet Glot!
Of course. I mean, I'm here. I'm not going to run to Brooklyn. But I have very destination places, and I'm very destination chef.
Because you want
chef.
The best.
Yes.
You want the best from that.
So I had a really hard time transitioning from the salsa from my favorite restaurant. And although it was all parve, it took me a while to, like, transition, like, to go away from not bring... I didn't bring it in the home, but I might have tasted it out. Mm-hmm. So then I stopped. I can't do this anymore. So then I try to recreate those items. Think about it, flavor levels, and recreate those items.
Susie, that's amazing. I know this is just a small snippet of Susie's journey. And throughout the year, you're going to come on and you're going to share a little bit more. Love you to come back and talk about recipes.
Well, that too. You know, I was adopted from a frum family.
Wow. Right.
My grandfather was religious. So
it's an amazing story that you've
had
and what you've got in front of you. You have a beautiful family.
Thank you.
A lot of nachas from them, and I love working with you.
Yeah, I love working with you.
And we're a perfect match together, because I'm good at my stuff and you're good at your stuff.
100%.
And we work together. Not sure what to do, we go to each other. With us, communication has been really key, and it's been
100%.
Really wonderful. Moishe, thank you so much for coming on the show.
It was great to be here.
You had to sit for the whole hour.
It's all good.
He's actually really happy he got to sit down. Lauren, thank you so much for coming on the show. I really loved having you. I'm going to enjoy my new knife.
It's a great knife, by the way.
Shout out from Susie. She put a signature on it too.
Yeah.
We had Rebecca from Israel, and we had Shani Seidman from our sponsorship from Manischewitz. Want to wish everyone Shabbat Shalom, Happy Shushan Purim, Happy Erev Pesach, and we have music sponsored by our friends at Kedep right up until Lich Benching. Shabbat Shalom.